Just ahead on CTV News tonight, a water main break cancels classes at the University of Maryland. The story and more coming up.
I don't know if I have water. I live like right across from buildings that don't have water, and I'm not on campus. So I don't know if I'm going to go back and have water or not.
I'm Patricia Vallone with a CTV News update. A water main break interrupts campus life at the University of Maryland today. A pipe broke near the Carroll Residence Hall on Pre-Inkert Drive this morning. University officials say dozens of residence halls, academic and administrative buildings have been impacted. According to the university, some facilities have little water pressure or none at all. CTV News spoke with students as water gushed through the streets on campus.
Water's out. Got to walk a bit to get water, some food. Showers, toilets don't work, but I mean, most of South Campus is out. A couple classes were canceled.
It's an inconvenience, and it's annoying because, like, there has been water running down here for, like, the past couple of days. And obviously, there's, like, way more today, but I don't know if, like, it's been something that's been going on, like, they knew about, but yeah, it's just very, very inconvenient.
University officials have canceled in-person classes at the impacted buildings. However, some professors have moved to online learning. And authorities are investigating a fatal stabbing in College Park, and they're calling it a domestic incident. Police were called to a home in the 3400 block of Metzerat Road around 8:40 last night. That's where they found the victim, 45-year-old Asinia Stewart, suffering from stab wounds. He later died at a hospital. Investigators say they have identified the individuals involved as family members, but so far no one has been charged. They are also still working to determine what led up to the incident. We are invisible. That was a complaint made by Latino politicians in October 2021 when they first spoke out about the lack of representation in Prince George's government. Now, 2 years later, Delegate Joseline Peña-Melnick says little has changed. Peña-Melnick says they have been asking County Executive Angela Alsobrooks for the last 4 years to appoint a Latino on the executive level. CTV spoke with the lawmaker during Hispanic Heritage Month.
For 4 years, she had 38 African Americans and one white. That is a problem. As a person that is both black and Latina, it is important to be at the table, especially when you look at what we went through with COVID, and to be able to bring those experiences for that community. She just hired someone after announcing she was running for the Senate. I believe that it is important that as leaders that we try to be inclusive.
And Peña-Melnick added some harsh words, saying Alsobrooks has not done a good job listening to the requests of the Hispanic community and that she's very disappointed that Latinos don't have a seat at the table. Well, Prince George's holds a ceremonial groundbreaking for a new health center in Greenbelt today. The facility is located here at the 9,000 block of Edmonston Road. The building, which was bought for about $9 million, will soon be turned into a state-of-the-art health center. Officials say about $18 to $20 million will be used to make renovations to the interior and exterior of the property. The center will help expand care by providing behavioral health, dental care, immunizations, and reproductive health services.
What you'll see here is not just a building for residents to get the care they need, but it's a big first step in enhancing healthcare services in Prince George's County so that we can focus on Prince George's overall health and well-being.
And folks, I'm going to make a bold promise that the general contractor or construction firm that we select down the road from now to build out and deliver this new county health clinic, I'm going to make a promise that it's going to be a county-based small and minority business. You can count on it for sure.
And the facility will replace the county's aging Chevrolet Health Center. The project is expected to be completed by the spring of 2026. And you are watching CTV News. I'm Patricia Vallone. Coming up, we're at the Showplace Arena in Upper Marlboro for the Washington International Horse Show. The details after the break. Stay with us. Me alicé, me risté, lo sufrí. I just follow the standards, you know what I mean. Ya cambié, me acepté y ahora soy más feliz. Porque cuando lo sientes is when you become free. No te preocupes si no te aprueban. Cuando te critiquen, tú solo di. Soy yo, soy, soy. Welcome back. Well, Maryland State Police are investigating a deadly pedestrian accident. It happened last night around 9:30 on Branch Avenue at Woodyard Road in Clinton. Investigators say 28-year-old Martin Miller of Clinton was found in the southbound lanes and was pronounced dead at the scene. The cause of the crash remains under investigation. Investigators say the driver did remain on the scene. Anyone who may have information on the incident is asked to contact police. Meantime, a fatal pedestrian hit and run in Lanham has police searching for the person responsible and the car involved. 28-year-old Franklin Membreno Mendez of New Carrollton was found deceased just after 4 Saturday morning on a roadway in the 7500 block of Ardwick-Ardmore Road. Investigators say he was in a minor collision 2 miles away in the 8900 block of Annapolis Road and was struck by another vehicle after exiting his car. Membreno Mendez became lodged in that car's windshield. The striking driver then drove to Ardwick Ardmore, left the victim on the road, and then fled. Police are looking for a gray Honda Civic with damage to the windshield. Anyone with info on the case is asked to call police. Municipal elections are right around the corner, and the city of Greenbelt is sending out mail-in ballots, but you have to request them. But voters must turn in their ballots by 6 p.m. on November 7th. You can return them by mail or use the drop boxes at Greenbelt Police Station, Schramm Hills Park, or Spring Hill Lake Recreation Center. Meantime, Bowie and College Park are also holding elections. College Park has two early voting days. The first one is this Wednesday at Davis Hall. The other is on November 2nd at City Hall. The month of October signals the return of the Washington International Horse Show to our area. Today was the first day of activities at the Showplace Arena. The week-long event is loaded with festivities for the entire family, including Kids Day and Barn Night. Organizers say the horse show is one of the most prestigious, competitive, and entertaining equestrian events in North America.
I would say this event is for anyone in general. First of all, if you'll come, you'll become a horse lover because you can't be around these animals and not fall in love with them. It's just so exciting for me. Maryland is like my home state, and Prince George's Equestrian Center, I have shown here for years. Mm-hmm. It's such an incredible facility, and the horses absolutely love it. So we're starting off the week with the hunters, and the hunters jump like they would in a hunting field over these beautiful natural-looking mm-hmm. obstacles. It's judged on form, and then as we move into the week, we'll continue to have hunters, and then the jumpers will come. And the jumpers are really speed and whether they keep the jumps up or not, and the jumps get a lot higher.
And the Washington International Horse Show goes through next Sunday. All events during the day are free. For more information about the show, you can go to wish.org. And after the break, Simon Bugs has highlights from another frustrating Commander's loss. We'll have those details. Stay with us.
What's going on, sports fans? And coming up on your Monday sports page, a recap of the Washington Commanders versus New York Giants game that was played yesterday. Stay right there.
Being blind doesn't always look how others may think.
Retinitis pigmentosa aimed to overwhelm my family.
It tried to cut me down. I know where to find support.
Learn more about treatments and cures at fightingblindness.org.
Thanks for staying with us. Well, from Jewel to Red Garnet to Covington to Batata, there are many types of sweet potatoes. And they are a great source of vitamins A and C, as well as fiber. Well, tonight, they are the topic of this installment of Grow With Us.
We're back with another segment of Grow With Us with Kevin Alsop of Nima's Gardens. Thanks for joining us. And today, we're talking about fall vegetables, in particular, sweet potatoes, which begin with what's called a slip. Talk about that a little bit.
Okay, well actually sweet potatoes are late spring, summer vegetables that you can still harvest in the fall. Okay, so this is really a sweet potato. And a sweet potato slips, all sweet potato slips is small plants that form out of a sweet potato. So you could suspend this in water, and people do. You suspend it in a cup of water, put your toothpicks in there, let it suspend in the water, and these roots will grow. And once they grow about 6 to 8 inches, or you can pull them off and plant sweet potato slips. So in essence, you'll see like these roots, because you probably could form some type of slips. So what you'll have is, and this is actually what a slip would look like, that.
So you don't plant seeds, you plant what's called a slip, and that will spawn other sweet potatoes. And these are planted, what, back in June, I guess it was?
Yeah, we planted these kind of late. But you want to plant them when it's at least 60 degrees on average. You need that warm temp.
How about any advice for the soil? It can't be a hard, compact soil, as I understand.
No, because sweet potatoes are a root crop, so that means they grow underneath the soil. So you want your soil nice and loose and loamy. Packed with compost, and you want it loose though.
Okay, show us your harvest.
Okay, so we're just going to pull a couple up. Usually, they're more died back, but this is a very vigorous crop this year. They're not really dying back as much, but as we can clearly see, they are ready. This is actually a perfect one, but every now and then we get these. Large ones, and when you're removing these sweet potatoes, you got to dig around them because you'll break this. They're very fragile. Don't get excited when you see one and start pulling, but you got to loosen the soil around it, tug it a little bit, loosen the soil around it, tug on it a little bit. Have patience with yourself with the sweet potato, and there you go.
Giant sweet potato.
Nice sweet potato, right?
And some good eating.
For sure.
So if someone wants advice on how to do this, what's the email address?
info@nemasgardens.com. That's info@nemas.gardens.com.
Okay, once again, Kevin Alsop, Nemas Gardens, we're with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
And once again, that email address is info@nemasgardens.com. Well, now we are moving on to sports with Simon Bugs.
Okay, everyone, we begin your Monday sports page with some NFL news. The Washington Commanders suffered another disappointing loss over the weekend, this time to the New York Giants, 14-7. This is now Washington's fourth loss in the last five games, but head coach Ron Rivera wants his team to stay encouraged.
To me, it's really about how you bounce back more than it is anything else. With 10 games left to go, you never know what's going to happen. But you got to take them one at a time. You got to stay focused on it. You know, we'll correct these things. There's some things, a lot of things that we can correct, a lot of things we're going to get better at. And we'll continue to get, work at it, and we'll see what happens.
Quarterback Sam Howell praised the defense after the game, but did say that the offense has to do better.
I felt like we had a good plan and had answers for everything that they might do. And we just weren't executing. So it's frustrating, but the good thing is our defense played well and kept us in the game and made some big plays, huge stops, the turnover. And we just got to do a better job offensively. If our defense gives up 14 points, and I think one of those touchdowns on a short field after my interception, we should win the football game. Hats off to our defense. They kept us in the game. We just got to do a better job offensively.
The Commanders are now 3-4 and will take the field next versus the Philadelphia Eagles on Sunday. Moving on to the NBA, the Washington Wizards lock up forward Denny Avdija, signing him to a contract extension. The extension is valued at $55 million over 4 years. Avdija, who was the ninth pick in the 2020 NBA draft, averaged 9 points, 6 boards, and 3 assists for Washington last season, and it looks like he will be a key piece for them moving forward. The Wizards begin their season versus the Indiana Pacers on Wednesday. And that is your Monday sports page. Simon Bugs, CTV Sports.
Thanks, Simon. And that wraps up our CTV News update. I'm Patricia Vallone. Join us again tomorrow. Have a great night.